Act 3 of The Merchant of Venice by William Shakespeare. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, visit LibriVox.org. The Merchant of Venice by William Shakespeare. Act 3. Scene 1. Venice, a street. Enter Salanio and Salarino.
Now, what news on the Rialto?
Why, yet it lives there unchecked that Antonio hath a ship of rich lading wrecked on the narrow seas, the Goodwins, I think they call the place, a very dangerous flat and fatal, where the carcasses of many a tall ship lie buried, as they say, if my gossip report be an honest woman of her word.
I would she were as lying a gossip in that as ever napped ginger, or made her neighbours believe she wept for the death of a third husband, but it is true, without any slips of prolixity or crossing the plain highway of talk, that the good Antonio, the honest Antonio, oh, that I had a title good enough to keep his name company.
Come, the full stop.
What sayest thou? Why, the end is, he hath lost a ship.
I would it might prove the end of his losses.
Let me say amen betimes, lest the devil cross my prayer, for here he comes in the likeness of a Jew.
Enter Shylock.
You knew none so well, none so well as you of my daughter's flight.
That's certain. I, for my part, knew the tailor that made the wings she flew withal.
And Shylock, for his own part, knew the bird was fledged, and then it is the complexion of them all to leave the dam.
She is damned for it.
That's certain, if the devil may be her judge.
My own flesh and blood to rebel.
Out upon it, old carrion! Rebels it at these years?
I say my daughter is my flesh and my blood.
There is more difference between thy flesh and hers than between jet and ivory, more between your bloods than there is between red wine and Rhenish. But tell us, do you hear whether Antonio hath had any loss at sea or no?
There I have another bad match, a bankrupt, a prodigal, who dare scarce show his head on the Rialto, a beggar that used to come so smug upon the mart. Let him look to his bond. He was wont to call me usurer. Let him look to his bond. He was wont to lend money for a Christian courtesy. Let him look to his bond.
Why, I am sure if he forfeit, thou wilt not take his flesh. What's that good for?
To bait fish withal. If it will feed nothing else, it will feed my revenge. He hath disgraced me, and hindered me 500,000, laughed at my losses, mocked at my gains, scorned my nation, thwarted my bargains, cooled my friends, heated mine enemies. And what his reason? I am a Jew. Hath not a Jew eyes? Hath not a Jew hands, organs, dimensions, senses, affections, passions, fed with the same food, hurt with the same weapons, subject to the same diseases, healed by the same means, warmed and cooled by the same winter and summer as a Christian is? If you prick us, do we not bleed? If you tickle us, do we not laugh? If you poison us, do we not die? And if you wrong us, shall we not revenge? If we are like you in the rest, we will resemble you in that. If a Jew wrong a Christian, what is his humility? Revenge! If a Christian wrong a Jew, what should his sufferance be by Christian example? Why, revenge! The villainy you teach me I will execute, and it shall go hard, but I will better the instruction.
Enter a servant.
Gentlemen, my master Antonio is at his house, and desires to speak with you both.
We have been up and down to seek him.
Enter Tibble.
Here comes another of the tribe. A third cannot be matched unless the devil himself turn Jew.
Exeunt Salanio, Salarino, and servant.
How now, Tibble? What news from Genoa? Hast thou found my daughter?
I often came where I did hear of her, but cannot find her.
Why, there, a diamond gone, cost me 2,000 ducats in Frankfurt. The curse never fell upon our nation till now. I never felt it till now. 2,000 ducats in that, and other precious, precious jewels! I would my daughter were dead at my foot, and the jewels in her ear! Would she were hearsed at my foot, and the ducats in her coffin! No news of them! Why so? And I know not what's spent in the search. Why, thou, loss upon loss! The thief gone with so much, and so much to find the thief! And no satisfaction, no revenge, nor no ill luck stirring but what lights on my shoulders, no sighs but of my breathing, no tears but of my shedding.
Yes, other men have ill luck too. Antonio, as I heard in Genoa...
What? Ill luck!
Hath an argosy cast away, coming from Tripolis.
Oh, I thank God! I thank God! Is it true?
I spoke with some of the sailors that escaped the wreck.
Oh, I thank thee, good Tibble! Good news! Where? In Genoa?
Your daughter spent in Genoa, as I heard, one night, 40 ducats.
Oh, thou stickst a dagger in me. I shall never see my gold again. 40 ducats at a sitting! 40 ducats!
There came divers of Antonio's creditors to my company to Venice, that swear he cannot choose but break.
I am very glad of it. I'll plague him. I'll torture him. I am glad of it.
One of them showed me a ring that he had of your daughter for a monkey.
Oh, out upon her! Thou torturest me, Tibble. It was my turquoise. I had it of Leah when I was a bachelor. I would not have given it for a wilderness of monkeys.
But Antonio is certainly undone.
Nay, that's true. That's very true. Go, Tibble, fee me an officer. Bespeak him a fortnight before. I will have the heart of him if he forfeit. For were he out of Venice, I can make but merchandise I will. Go, Tibble, and meet me at our synagogue. Go, good Tibble, at our synagogue, Tibble.
Exeunt. Scene 2. Belmont. A room in Portia's house. Enter Bassanio, Portia, Gratiano, Nerissa, and attendants.
I pray you tarry. Pause a day or two before you hazard, for in choosing wrong I lose your company. Therefore forbear a while. There's something tells me, but it is not love, I would not lose you. And you know yourself, hate counsels not in such a quality. But lest you should not understand me well, and yet a maiden hath no tongue but thought, I would detain you here some month or two before you venture for me. I could teach you how to choose right, but then I am forsworn. So will I never be, so may you miss me. But if you do, you'll make me wish a sin that I had been forsworn. Beshrew your eyes! They have o'erlooked me and divided me. One half of me is yours, the other half yours. Mine own, I would say, but if mine, then yours, and so all yours. Oh, these naughty times puts bars between the owners and their rights, and so, though yours, not yours. Prove it so. Let fortune go to hell for it, not I. I speak too long, but 'tis to appease the time, to eke it and to draw it out in length, to stay you from election.
Let me choose, for as I am, I live upon the rack.
Upon the rack, Bassanio? Then confess what treason there is mingled with your love.
None but that ugly treason of mistrust, which makes me fear the enjoying of my love. There may as well be amity and life tween snow and fire as treason and my love.
Aye, but I fear you speak upon the rack, where men enforced do speak anything.
Promise me life, and I'll confess the truth.
Well then, confess and live.
Confess and love had been the very sum of my confession. Oh, happy torment, when my torturer doth teach me answers for deliverance. But let me to my fortune and the caskets.
Away, then. I am locked in one of them. If you do love me, you will find me out. Nerissa and the rest stand all aloof. Let music sound while he doth make his choice. Then, if he lose, he makes a swan-like end, fading in music. That the comparison may stand more proper, my eye shall be the stream and watery deathbed for him. He may win, and what is music then? Then music is even as the flourish when true subjects bow to a new crowned monarch. Such it is, as are those dulcet sounds in break of day that creep into the dreaming bridegroom's ear and summon him to marriage. Now he goes, with no less presence, but with much more love, than young Alcides, when he did redeem the virgin tribute paid by howling Troy to the sea monster. I stand for sacrifice. The rest aloof are the Dardanian wives, with bleared visages come forth to view the issue of the exploit. Go, Hercules! Live thou, I live. With much, much more dismay I view the fight than thou that makest the fray.
A song, while Bassanio comments on the caskets to himself.
Tell me where is fancy bred, or in the heart or in the head? How be he got, how nourished? Reply, reply. It is engendered in the eyes, with gazing fed, and fancy dies in the cradle where it lies. Let us all ring fancy's knell. I'll begin it. Ding dong bell, ding dong bell.
So may the outward shows be least themselves. The world is still deceived with ornament. In law, what plea so tainted and corrupt, but being seasoned with a gracious voice, obscures the show of evil? In religion, what damned error, but some sober brow will bless it and approve it with a text, hiding the grossness with fair ornament? There is no vice so simple but assumes some mark of virtue on his outward parts. How many cowards, whose hearts are all as false as stairs of sand, wear yet upon their chins the beards of Hercules and frowning Mars, who, inward searched, have livers white as milk, and these assume but valour's excrement to render them redoubted? Look on beauty, and you shall see 'tis purchased by the weight, which therein works a miracle in nature, making them lightest that wear most of it. So are those crisped, snaky, golden locks, which make such wanton gambols with the wind, upon supposed fairness, often known to be the dowry of a second head, the skull that bred them in the sepulchre. Thus ornament is but the guiled shore to a most dangerous sea, the beauteous scarf veiling an Indian beauty. In a word, the seeming truth which cunning times put on to entrap the wisest. Therefore, thou gaudy gold, hard food for Midas, I will none of thee, nor none of thee, thou pale and common drudge tween man and man. But thou meagre lead, which rather threatenest than dost promise aught, thy plainness moves me more than eloquence, and here choose I. Joy be the consequence.
Aside.
How all the other passions fleet to air, as doubtful thoughts and rash embrace despair, and shuddering fear and green-eyed jealousy. O love, be moderate, allay thy ecstasy, in measure reign thy joy, scant this excess. I feel too much thy blessing, make it less, for fear I surfeit.
What find I here?
Opening the leaden casket.
Fair Portia's counterfeit! What demigod hath come so near creation? Move these eyes, or whether, riding on the balls of mine, seem they in motion. Here are severed lips, parted with sugar breath. So sweet a bar should sunder such sweet friends. Here in her hairs the painter plays the spider, and hath woven a golden mesh to entrap the hearts of men faster than gnats in cobwebs. But her eyes! How could he see to do them? Having made one, methinks it should have power to steal both his and leave itself unfurnished. Yet look how far the substance of my praise doth wrong this shadow in underprizing it, so far this shadow doth limp behind the substance. Here's the scroll, the continent and summary of my fortune. You that choose not by the view, chance is fair and choose as true. Since this fortune falls to you, be content and seek no new. If you be well pleased with this, and hold your fortune for your bliss, turn to where your lady is, and claim her with a loving kiss. A gentle scroll. Fair lady, by your leave.
Kissing her.
I come by note to give and to receive. Like one of two contending in a prize, that thinks he hath done well in people's eyes, hearing applause and universal shout, giddy in spirit, still gazing in a doubt whether these pearls of praise be his or no. So, thrice, fair lady, stand I, even so, as doubtful whether what I see be true, until confirmed, signed, ratified, by you.
You see me, Lord Bassanio, where I stand, such as I am. Though for myself alone I would not be ambitious in my wish to wish myself much better, yet for you I would be trebled 20 times myself, 1,000 times more fair, 10,000 times more rich, that only to stand high in your account I might in virtues, beauties, livings, friends exceed account. But the full sum of me is sum of something which, to term in gross, is an unlessoned girl, unschooled, unpracticed, happy in this, she is not yet so old but she may learn, happier than this, she is not bred so dull but she can learn, happiest of all is that her gentle spirit commits itself to yours to be directed, as from her lord, her governor, her king. Myself and what is mine to you and yours is now converted. But now I was the lord of this fair mansion, master of my servants, queen or myself. And even now, but now, this house, these servants, and this same myself are yours, my lord's. I give them with this ring, which when you part from, lose, or give away, let it presage the ruin of your love, and be my vantage to exclaim on you.
Madam, you've bereft me of all words. Only my blood speaks to you in my veins, and there is such confusion in my powers, as after some oration fairly spoke by a beloved prince there doth appear among the buzzing pleased multitude, where every something, being blent together, turns to a wild of nothing, save of joy, expressed and not expressed. But when this ring parts from this finger, then parts life from hence. Oh, then be bold to say, Bassanio's dead.
My lord and lady, it is now our time that have stood by and seen our wishes prosper to cry. Good joy, my lord and lady.
My lord Bassanio and my gentle lady, I wish you all the joy that you can wish, for I am sure that you can wish none from me. And when your honours mean to solemnize the bargain of your faith, I do beseech you, even at that time, I may be married too.
With all my heart, so thou canst get a wife.
I thank your lordship, you have got me one. My eyes, my lord, can look as swift as yours. You saw the mistress, I beheld the maid. You loved, I loved. For intermission no more pertains to me, my lord, than you. Your fortune stood upon the caskets there, and so did mine too, as the matter falls. For wooing here until I sweat again, and swearing till my very roof was dry with oaths of love, at last, if promise last, I got a promise of this fair one here to have her love. provided that your fortune achieved her mistress.
Is this true, Nerissa?
Madame, it is. So you stand pleased withal?
And do you, Gratiano, mean good faith?
Yes, faith, my lord.
Our feast shall be much honored in your marriage.
We'll play with them the first boy for 1,000 ducats.
What? And stake down?
No, we shall ne'er win at that sport and stake down. But who comes here? Lorenzo and his infidel? What, and my old Venetian friend Salanio?
Enter Lorenzo, Jessica, and Salanio.
Lorenzo and Salanio! Welcome hither, if that the youth of my new interest here have power to bid you welcome. By your leave, I bid my very friends and countrymen, sweet Portia, welcome.
So do I, my lord. They are entirely welcome.
I thank your honor. For my part, my lord, my purpose was not to have seen you here. But meeting with Salanio, by the way, he did entreat me, past all saying nay, to come with him along.
I did, my lord. And I have reason for it. Signor Antonio commends him to you.
Gives Bassanio a letter.
Ere I ope his letter, I pray you tell me how my good friend doth.
Not sick, my lord, unless it be in mind, nor well, unless in mind. His letter there will show you his estate.
Nerissa, cheer yon stranger, bid her welcome. Your hand, Salanio. What's the news from Venice? How doth that royal merchant, good Antonio? I know he will be glad of our success. We are the Jasons. We have won the fleece.
I would you had won the fleece that he hath lost.
There are some shrewd contents in yon same paper that steal the color from Bassanio's cheek. Some dear friend dead, else nothing in the world could turn so much the constitution of any constant man. What, worse and worse! With leave, Bassanio. I am half yourself, and I must freely have the half of anything that this same paper brings you.
Oh, sweet Portia, here are a few of the unpleasantest words that ever blotted paper. Gentle lady, when I did first impart my love to you, I freely told you all the wealth I had ran in my veins. I was a gentleman. And then I told you true, and yet, dear lady, rating myself at nothing, you shall see how much I was a braggart. When I told you my state was nothing, I should then have told you that I was worse than nothing. For indeed I have engaged myself to a dear friend, engaged my friend to his mere enemy to feed my means. Here is a letter, lady. The paper has the body of my friend, and every word in it a gaping wound issuing life-blood. But is it true, Salario? Have all his ventures failed? What, not one hit? From Tripolis? From Mexico and England? From Lisbon, Barbary, and India? And not one vessel scaped the dreadful touch of merchant-marring rocks?
Not one, my lord. Besides, it should appear that if he had the present money to discharge the Jew, he would not take it. Never did I know a creature that did bear the shape of man, so keen and greedy to confound a man. He plies the Duke at morning and at night, and doth impeach the freedom of the state if they deny him justice. 20 merchants of the Duke himself, and the magnificos of greatest port, have all persuaded with him, but none can drive him from the envious plea of forfeiture, of justice, and his bond.
When I was with him, I have heard him swear to Tibble and to Chuse, his countrymen, that he would rather have Antonio's flesh than 20 times the value of the sum that he did owe him. And I know, my lord, if law, authority, and power deny not, it will go hard with poor Antonio.
Is it your dear friend that is thus in trouble?
The dearest friend to me, the kindest man, the best-conditioned and unwearied spirit in doing courtesies, and one in whom the ancient Roman honour more appears than any that draws breath in Italy.
What sum owes he the Jew?
For me, 3,000 ducats.
What, no more? Pay him 6,000, and deface the bond. Double 6,000, and then treble that, before a friend of this description shall lose a hair through Bassanio's fault. First go with me to church, and call me wife, and then away to Venice to your friend, for never shall you lie by Portia's side with an unquiet soul. You shall have gold to pay the petty debt 20 times over. When it is paid, bring your true friend along. My maid Nerissa and myself, meantime, will live as maids and widows. Come, away, for you shall hence upon your wedding day. Bid your friends welcome, show a merry cheer. Since you are dear bought, I will love you dear. But let me hear the letter of your friend.
Sweet Bassanio, my ships have all miscarried. My creditors grow cruel. My estate is very low. My bond to the Jew is forfeit. And since in paying it, it is impossible I should live, all debts are cleared between you and I, if I might but see you at my death. Notwithstanding, use your pleasure. If your love do not persuade you to come, let not my letter.
Oh, love, dispatch all business and be gone.
Since I have your good leave to go away, I will make haste. But till I come again, no bed shall e'er be guilty of my stay, no rest be interposer twixt us twain.
Exeunt. Scene 3. Venice, a street. Enter Shylock, Salarino, Antonio, and Jailer.
Jailer, look to him. Tell me not of mercy. This is the fool that lent out money gratis. Jailer, look to him.
Hear me yet, good Shylock.
I'll have my bond. Speak not against my bond. I have sworn an oath that I will have my bond. Thou call'dst me dog before thou hadst a cause. But since I am a dog, beware my fangs. The Duke shall grant me justice. I do wonder, thou naughty jailer, that thou art so fond to come abroad with him at his request.
I pray thee, hear me speak.
I'll have my bond. I'll not hear thee speak. I'll have my bond, and therefore speak no more. I'll not be made a soft and dull-eyed fool to shake the head, relent, and sigh, and yield to Christian intercessors. Follow not. I'll have no speaking. I will have my bond.
Exit.
It is the most impenetrable cur that ever kept with men.
Let him alone. I'll follow him no more with bootless prayers. He seeks my life. His reason well I know. I oft delivered from his forfeitures many that have at times made moan to me. Therefore he hates me.
I am sure the Duke will never grant this forfeiture to hold.
The Duke cannot deny the course of law, for the commodity that strangers have with us in Venice, if it be denied, 'twill much impeach the justice of the state, since that the trade and profit of the city consisteth of all nations. Therefore go. These griefs and losses have so baited me that I shall hardly spare a pound of flesh tomorrow to my bloody creditor. Well, Gowler, on. Pray God, Bassanio come to see me pay his debt, and then I care not.
Exeunt. Scene 4. Belmont, a room in Portia's house. Enter Portia, Nerissa, Lorenzo, Jessica, and Balthazar.
Madam, although I speak it in your presence, you have a noble and a true conceit of godlike amity, which appears most strongly in bearing thus the absence of your lord. But if you knew to whom you show this honor, how true a gentleman you send relief, how dear a lover of my lord your husband, I know you would be prouder of the work than customary bounty can enforce you.
I never did repent for doing good, nor shall not now. For in companions that do converse and waste the time together, whose souls do bear an equal yoke of love, there must be needs a like proportion of lineaments, of manners, and of spirit, which makes me think that this Antonio, being the bosom lover of my lord, must needs be like my lord. If it be so, how little is the cost I have bestowed in purchasing the semblance of my soul from out the state of hellish cruelty! This comes too near the praising of myself, therefore no more of it. Hear other things. Lorenzo, I commit into your hands the husbandry and manage of my house until my lord's return. For mine own part, I have toward heaven breathed a secret vow to live in prayer and contemplation, only attended by Nerissa here, until her husband and my lord's return. There is a monastery 2 miles off, and there we will abide. I do desire you not to deny this imposition, the which my love and some necessity now lays upon you.
Madam, with all my heart I shall obey you in all fair commands.
My people do already know my mind, and will acknowledge you and Jessica in place of Lord Bassanio and myself. so fare you well till we shall meet again.
Fair thoughts and happy hours attend on you.
I wish your ladyship all heart's content.
I thank you for your wish, and am well pleased to wish it back on you. Fare you well, Jessica.
Exeunt Jessica and Lorenzo.
Now, Balthazar, as I have ever found thee honest true, so let me find thee still. Take this same letter, and use thou all the endeavour of a man in speed to Padua. See thou render this into my cousin's hands, Dr. Bellario, and look what notes and garments he doth give thee. Bring them, I pray thee, with imagined speed unto the traject, to the common ferry which trades to Venice. Waste no time in words, but get thee gone. I shall be there before thee.
Madam, I go with all convenient speed.
Exit.
Come on, Nerissa. I have work in hand that you yet know not of. We'll see our husbands before they think of us.
Shall they see us?
They shall, Nerissa, but in such a habit that they shall think we are accomplished with that we lack. I'll hold thee any wager. When we are both accoutred like young men, I'll prove the prettier fellow of the two, and wear my dagger with the braver grace, and speak between the change of man and boy with a reed voice, and turn two mincing steps into a manly stride, and speak of phrase like a fine bragging youth, and tell quaint lies, how honourable ladies sought my love, which I, denying, they fell sick and died, I could not do withal. Then I'll repent, and wish for all that I had not killed them. And 20 of these puny lies I'll tell, that men shall swear I have discontinued school about a twelvemonth. I have within my mind 1,000 raw tricks of these bragging jacks, which I will practice.
Why, shall we turn to men?
Fie! What a question's that, if thou wert near a lewd interpreter? But come, I'll tell thee all my whole device when I am in my coach, which stays for us at the park gate, and therefore haste away, for we must measure 20 miles to-day.
Exeunt. Scene 5. The same. A garden. Enter Launcelot and Jessica.
Yes, truly. For look you, the sins of the father are to be laid upon the children. Therefore, I promise you, I fear you. And I was always plain with you, and so now I speak my agitation of the matter. Therefore, be good of cheer, for truly I think you are damned. There is but one hope in it that can do you any good, and that is but a kind of bastard hope neither.
And what hope is that, I pray thee?
Mary, you may partly hope that your father got you not, that you are not the Jew's daughter.
That were a kind of bastard hope indeed. So the sins of my mother should be visited upon me.
Truly, then, I fear you are damned, both by father and mother. Thus, when I shun Scylla, your father, I fall into Charybdis, your mother. Well, you are gone both ways.
I shall be saved by my husband. He hath made me a Christian.
Truly, the more to blame he. We were Christians enow before, e'en as many as could well live one by another. This making of Christians will raise the price of hogs. If we grow all to be pork-eaters, we shall not shortly have a rasher on the coals for money.
I'll tell my husband, Launcelot, what you say. Here he comes.
Enter Lorenzo.
I shall grow jealous of you shortly, Launcelot, if you thus get my wife into corners.
Nay, you need not fear us, Lorenzo. Launcelot and I are out. He tells me flatly there's no mercy for me in heaven because I am a Jew's daughter. And he says you are no good member of the commonwealth, for in converting Jews to Christians you raise the price of pork.
I shall answer that better to the commonwealth than you can the getting up of the negro's belly. The Moor is with child by you, Launcelot.
It is much that the Moor should be more than reason. But if she be less than an honest woman, she is indeed more than I took her for.
How every fool can play upon the word. I think the best grace of wit will shortly turn into silence, and discourse grow commendable in none only but parrots. Go in, sirrah, bid them prepare for dinner.
That is done, sir. They have all stomachs.
Goodly lord, what a wit-snapper are you. Then bid them prepare dinner.
That is done too, sir. Only cover is the word.
Will you cover, then, sir?
Not so, sir. Neither. I know my duty.
Yet more quarrelling with occasion. Wilt thou show the whole wealth of thy wit in an instant? I pray thee understand a plain man in his plain meaning. Go to thy fellows, bid them cover the table, serve in the meat, and we will come in to dinner.
For the table, sir, it shall be served in. For the meat, sir, it should be covered. For your coming in to dinner, sir, why, let it be as humours and conceits shall govern.
Exit.
Oh, dear discretion, how his words are suited! The fool hath planted in his memory an army of good words, and I do know a many fools that stand in better place, garnished like him, that for a tricksy word defy the matter. How cheerest thou, Jessica? And now, good sweet, say thy opinion. How dost thou like the Lord Bassanio's wife?
Past all expressing. It is very meet the Lord Bassanio live an upright life, for having such a blessing in his lady, he finds the joys of heaven here on earth. And if on earth he do not merit it, in reason he should never come to heaven. Why, if two gods should play some heavenly match, and on the wager lay two earthly women, and Portia one, there must be something else pawned with the other, for the poor rude world hath not her fellow.
Even such a husband hath thou of me, as she is for a wife.
Nay, but ask my opinion, too, of that.
I will, Anon. First let us go to dinner.
Nay, let me praise you while I have a stomach.
No, pray thee, let it serve for table talk. Then, howsoe'er thou speakest, among other things, I shall digest it.
Well, I'll set you forth.
Exeunt. End of Act 3. The Merchant of Venice, Act 4. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, visit LibriVox.org. The Merchant of Venice by William Shakespeare. Act 4. Scene 1. Venice, a court of justice. Enter the Duke. The Magnificoes. Antonio, Bassanio, Gratiano, Salarino, Salanio, and others.
What, is Antonio here?
Ready, so please your grace.
I am sorry for thee. Thou art come to answer a stony adversary, an inhuman wretch, incapable of pity, void and empty, from any dream of mercy.
I have heard your grace has ta'en great pains to qualify his rigorous course. But since he stands obdurate, and that no lawful means can carry me out of his envy's reach, I do oppose my patience to his fury, and am armed to suffer with a quietness of spirit the very tyranny and rage of his.
Go, one, and call the Jew into the court.
He is ready at the door. He comes, my lord.
Enter Shylock.
Make room, and let him stand before our face. Shylock, the world thinks, and I think so too, that thou but leadest this fashion of thy malice to the last hour of act, and then, 'tis thought, thou'lt show thy mercy and remorse more strange than is thy strange apparent cruelty. And where thou now exact the penalty, which is a pound of this poor merchant's flesh, thou wilt not only lose the forfeiture, but touched with human gentleness and love, forgive a moiety of the principal, glancing an eye of pity on his losses, that have of late so huddled on his back, enow to press a royal merchant down, and pluck commiseration of his state, for brassy bosoms and rough hearts of flint, from stubborn Turks and Tartars, never trained to offices of tender courtesy. We all expect a gentle answer, Jew.
I have possessed your grace of what I purpose, and by our holy Sabbath have I sworn to have the due and forfeit of my bond. If you deny it, let the danger light upon your charter and your city's freedom. You'll ask me why I rather choose to have a weight of carrion flesh than to receive 3,000 ducats. I'll not answer that, but say it is my humour. Is it answered? What if my house be troubled with a rat, and I be pleased to give 10,000 ducats to have it banged? What are you answered yet? Some men there are love not a gaping pig, some that are mad if they behold a cat, and others, when the bagpipe sings in the nose, cannot contain their urine. For affection, mistress of passion, sways it to the mood of what it likes or loathes. Now, for your answer, as there is no firm reason to be rendered why he cannot abide a gaping pig, why he a harmless necessary cat, why he a walling bagpipe, but of force must yield to such inevitable shame as to offend, himself being offended, so can I give no reason, nor will I not, more than a lodged hate, and a certain loathing I bear Antonio, that I follow thus a losing suit against him. Are you answered?
This is no answer, thou unfeeling man, to excuse the current of thy cruelty.
I am not bound to please thee with my answer.
Do all men kill the things they do not love?
Hates any man the thing he would not kill?
Every offence is not a hate at first.
What, wouldst thou have a serpent sting thee twice?
I pray you think you question with the Jew. You may as well go stand upon the beach and bid the main flood bait his usual height. You may as well use question with the wolf why he hath made the ewe bleat for the lamb. You may as well forbid the mountain pines to wag their high tops, and to make no noise when they are threatened with the gusts of heaven. May as well do anything most hard as to seek to soften that, than which what's harder, his Jewish heart. Therefore I do beseech you, make no more offers, use no farther means, but with all brief and plain conveniency. Let me have judgment, and the Jew his will.
For thy 3,000 ducats, here is 6.
If every ducat in 6,000 ducats were in 6 parts, and every part a ducat, I would not draw them. I would have my bond.
How shalt thou hope for mercy, rendering none?
What judgment shall I dread, doing no wrong? You have among you many a purchased slave, which, like your asses and your dogs and mules, you use in abject and in slavish parts, because you bought them. Shall I say to you, let them be free, marry them to your heirs? Why sweat they under burdens? Let their beds be made as soft as yours, and let their palates be seasoned with such viands. You will answer, the slaves are ours. So do I answer you. The pound of flesh, which I demand of him, is dearly bought. 'Tis mine, and I will have it. If you deny me, fie upon your law. There is no force in the decrees of Venice. I stand for judgment. Answer, shall I have it?
Upon my power, I may dismiss this court, unless Bellario, a learned doctor, whom I have sent for to determine this, come here today.
My lord, here stays without a messenger with letters from the doctor, new come from Padua.
Bring us the letters. Call the messenger.
Good cheer, Antonio. What, man, courage yet? The Jew shall have my flesh, blood, bones, and all, ere thou shalt lose for me one drop of blood.
I am a tainted wether of the flock, meetest for death. The weakest kind of fruit drops earliest to the ground. And so let me. You cannot better be employed, Bassanio, than to live still and write mine epitaph.
Enter Nerissa, dressed like a lawyer's clerk.
Came you from Padua? From Bellario?
From both, my lord. Bellario greets your grace.
Presents a letter.
Why dost thou whet thy knife so earnestly?
To cut the forfeiture from that bankrupt there.
Not on thy soul, but on thy soul, harsh Jew, thou makest thy knife keen. But no metal can, no, not the hangman's axe, bear half the keenness of thy sharp envy. Can no prayers pierce thee?
No, none that thou hast wit enough to make.
Oh, be thou damned, inexorable dog! And for thy life, let justice be accused. Thou almost makest me waver in my faith to hold opinion with Pythagoras, that souls of animals infuse themselves into the trunks of men. Thy currish spirit governed a wolf, who, hanged for human slaughter, even from the gallows did his fell soul fleet, and whilst thou layst in thy unhallowed dam, infused itself in thee, for thy desires are wolfish, bloody, starved, and ravenous.
Till thou canst rail the seal from off my bond, thou but offence thy lungs to speak so loud. Repair thy wit, good youth, or it will fall to cureless ruin. I stand here for law.
This letter from Bellario doth commend a young and learned doctor to our court. Where is he?
He attendeth here hard by, to know your answer, whether you'll admit him.
With all my heart. Some 3 or 4 of you, go, give him courteous conduct to this place. Meantime, the court shall hear Bellario's letter.
Your grace shall understand that, at the receipt of your letter, I am very sick. But in the instant that your messenger came, in loving visitation was with me a young doctor of Rome. His name is Balthazar. I acquainted him with the cause in controversy between the Jew and Antonio the merchant. We turned o'er many books together. He is furnished with my opinion, which, bettered with his own learning, the greatness whereof I cannot enough commend, comes with him at my importunity, to fill up your grace's request in my stead. I beseech you, let his lack of years be no impediment to let him lack a reverent estimation, for I never knew so young a body with so old a head. I leave him to your gracious acceptance, whose trial shall better publish his commendation.
You hear the learned Bellario, what he writes, and here, I take it, is a doctor come.
Enter Portia, dressed like a doctor of laws.
You're welcome. Take your place. Are you acquainted with the difference that holds this present question in the court?
I am informed truly of the cause. Which is the merchant here, and which the Jew?
Antonio and old Shylock, both stand forth.
Is your name Shylock?
Shylock is my name.
Of a strange nature is the suit you follow, yet in such rule that the Venetian law cannot impugn you as you do proceed.
To Antonio.
You stand within his danger, do you not?
Aye, so he says.
Do you confess the bond?
I do.
Then must the Jew be merciful.
On what compulsion must I? Tell me that.
The quality of mercy is not strained. It droppeth as the gentle rain from heaven upon the place beneath. It is twice blessed. It blesseth him that gives and him that takes. 'Tis mightiest in the mightiest. It becomes the throned monarch better than his crown. His sceptre shows the force of temporal power, the attribute to awe and majesty wherein doth sit the dread and fear of kings. But mercy is above this sceptred sway. It is enthroned in the hearts of kings. It is an attribute to God himself. And earthly power doth then show likest gods when mercy seasons justice. Therefore, Jew, though justice be thy plea, consider this, that in the course of justice none of us should see salvation. We do pray for mercy, and that same prayer doth teach us all to render the deeds of mercy. I have spoke thus much to mitigate the justice of thy plea, which, if thou follow, this strict court of Venice must needs give sentence gainst the merchant there.
My deeds upon my head. I crave the law, the penalty and forfeit of my bond.
Is he not able to discharge the money?
Yes, here I tender it for him in the court, yea, twice the sum. If that will not suffice, I will be bound to pay it 10 times o'er, on forfeit of my hands, my head, my heart. If this will not suffice, it must appear that malice bears down truth. And I beseech you, rest once the law to your authority. To do a great right, do a little wrong, and curb this cruel devil of his will.
It must not be. There is no power in Venice can alter a decree established. 'Twill be recorded for a precedent, and many an error by the same example will rush into this state. It cannot be.
Ah, Daniel, come to judgment! Yea, a Daniel! O wise young judge, how I do honor thee!
I pray you, let me look upon the bond.
Here 'tis, most reverend doctor, here it is.
Shylock, there's thrice thy money offered thee.
An oath. An oath. I have an oath in heaven. Shall I lay perjury upon my soul? No, not for Venice.
Why, this bond is forfeit, and lawfully by this the Jew may claim a pound of flesh, to be by him cut off nearest the merchant's heart. Be merciful. Take thrice thy money. Bid me tear the bond.
When it is paid according to the tenor. It doth appear you are a worthy judge. You know the law. Your exposition hath been most sound. I charge you, by the law, whereof you are a well-deserving pillar, proceed to judgment. By my soul, I swear, there is no power in the tongue of man to alter me. I stay here upon my bond.
Most heartily, I do beseech the court to give the judgment.
Why, then, thus it is. You must prepare your bosom for his knife.
Oh, noble judge, oh, excellent young man.
For the intent and purpose of the law hath full relation to the penalty, which here appeareth due upon the bond.
'Tis very true, O wise and upright judge, how much more elder art thou than thy looks.
Therefore, lay bare your bosom.
Aye, his breast, so says the bond, doth it not, noble judge? Nearest his heart, those are the very words.
It is so. Are there balance here to weigh the flesh?
I have them ready.
Have by some surgeon, Shylock, on your charge, to stop his wounds lest he do bleed to death.
Is it so nominated in the bond?
It is not so expressed, but what of that? 'Twere good you do so much for charity.
I cannot find it. 'Tis not in the bond.
You, merchant, have you anything to say?
But little. I am armed and well prepared. Give me your hand, Bassanio. Fare you well. Grieve not that I am fallen to this for you. For herein fortune shows herself more kind than is her custom. It is still her use to let the wretched man outlive his wealth, to view with hollow eye and wrinkled brow an age of poverty, from which lingering penance of such misery does she cut me off. Commend me to your honorable wife. Tell her the process of Antonio's end. Say how I loved you. Speak me fair in death. And when the tale is told, bid her be judge whether Bassanio had not once a love. Repent but you that you shall lose your friend, and he repents not that he pays your debt. For if the Jew do cut but deep enough, I'll pay it instantly, with all my heart.
Antonio, I am married to a wife which is as dear to me as life itself. But life itself, my wife and all the world, are not with me esteemed above thy life. I would lose all, I sacrifice them all here to this devil, to deliver you.
Your wife would give you little thanks for that if she were by to hear you make the offer.
I have a wife whom, I protest, I love. I would she were in heaven, so she could entreat some power to change this currish Jew.
'Tis well you offer it behind her back, for which would else make an unquiet house.
These be the Christian husbands. I have a daughter. Would any of the stock of Barabbas had been her husband rather than a Christian? We trifle time. I pray thee, pursue sentence.
A pound of that same merchant's flesh is thine. The court awards it, and the law doth give it.
Most rightful judge.
And you must cut this flesh from off his breast. The law allows it, and the court awards it.
Most learned judge, a sentence, come prepare.
Tarry a little. There is something else. This bond doth give thee here no jot of blood. The words expressly are a pound of flesh. Take then thy bond. Take thou thy pound of flesh, but in the cutting it, if thou dost shed one drop of Christian blood, thy lands and goods are by the laws of Venice confiscate unto the state of Venice.
O upright judge! Mark, Jew, O learned judge!
Is that the law?
Thyself shalt see the act. For, as thou urgest justice, be assured thou shalt have justice more than thou desirest.
O learned judge! Mark, Jew, a learned judge!
I take this offer, then. Pay the bond thrice, and let the Christian go.
Here is the money.
Soft! The Jew shall have all justice. Soft, no haste. He shall have nothing but the penalty.
O Jew, an upright judge, a learned judge!
Therefore, prepare thee to cut off the flesh. Shed thou no blood, nor cut thou less nor more, but just a pound of flesh. If thou takest more, or less, than a just pound, be it but so much as makes it light or heavy in the substance, or the division of the 20th part of one poor scruple. Nay, if the scale do turn but in the estimation of a hair, thou diest, and all thy goods are confiscate.
A second Daniel, a Daniel, Jew! Now, infidel, I have you on the hip!
Why doth the Jew pause? Take thy forfeiture.
Give me my principal, and let me go.
I have it ready for thee. Here it is.
He hath refused it in the open court. He shall have merely justice and his bond.
A Daniel, still I say, a second Daniel. I thank thee, Jew, for teaching me that word.
Shall I not have barely my principal?
Thou shalt have nothing but the forfeiture, to be so taken at thy peril, Jew.
Why, then, the devil give him good of it. I'll stay no longer question.
Tarry, Jew. The law hath yet another hold on you. It is enacted in the laws of Venice. If it be proved against an alien that by direct or indirect attempts he seek the life of any citizen, the part against the which he doth contrive shall seize one half his goods. The other half comes to the privy coffer of the state, and the offender's life lies in the mercy of the Duke only, against all other voice. In which predicament, I say, thou standst? For it appears by manifest proceeding that indirectly and directly too thou hast contrived against the very life of the defendant, and thou hast incurred the danger formerly by me rehearsed. Down, therefore, and beg mercy of the Duke.
Beg that thou mayst have leave to hang thyself, and yet, thy wealth being forfeit to the state, thou hast not left the value of a cord. Therefore thou must be hanged at the state's charge.
That thou shalt see the difference of our spirits, I pardon thee thy life before thou ask it. For half thy wealth it is Antonio's. The other half comes to the general state, which humbleness may drive unto a fine.
I for the state, not for Antonio.
Nay, take my life and all, pardon not that. You take my house when you do take the prop that doth sustain my house. You take my life when you do take the means whereby I live.
What mercy can you render him, Antonio?
A halter, gratis, nothing else for God's sake.
So please my lord the Duke, and all the court, to quit the fine for one half of his goods. I am content, so he will let me have the other half in use, to render it upon his death unto the gentleman that lately stole his daughter. Two things provided more, that for this favor he presently become a Christian, the other, that he do record a gift here in the court of all he dies possessed unto his son Lorenzo and his daughter.
He shall do this, or else I do recount the pardon that I late pronounced here.
Art thou contented, Jew? What dost thou say?
I am content.
Clerk, draw a deed of gift.
I pray you, give me leave to go from hence. I am not well. Send the deed after me, and I will sign it.
Get thee gone, but do it.
In christening shalt thou have two godfathers. Had I been judge, thou shouldst have had 10 more, to bring thee to the gallows, not to the font.
Exit Shylock.
Sir, I entreat you home with me to dinner.
I humbly do desire your grace of pardon. I must away this night toward Padua, and it is meet I presently set forth.
I am sorry that your leisure serves you not. Antonio, gratify this gentleman, for in my mind you are much bound to him.
Exit Duke, Magnificoes, and train.
Most worthy gentlemen, I and my friend have by your wisdom been this day acquitted of grievous penalties. in lieu whereof 3,000 ducats due unto the Jew, we freely cope your courteous pains withal.
And stand indebted over and above in love and service to you evermore.
He is well paid that is well satisfied, and I, delivering you, am satisfied, and therein do account myself well paid. My mind was never yet more mercenary. I pray you, know me when we meet again. I wish you well, and so I take my leave.
Dear sir, of force I must attempt you further. Take some remembrance of us as a tribute, not as a fee. Grant me two things, I pray you, not to deny me, and to pardon me.
You press me far, and therefore I will yield.
To Antonio.
Give me your gloves, I'll wear them for your sake.
To Bassanio.
And for your love, I'll take this ring from you. Do not draw back your hand. I'll take no more, and you in love shall not deny me this.
This ring, good sir, alas, it is a trifle. I will not shame myself to give you this.
I will have nothing else but only this, and now methinks I have a mind to it.
There's more depends on this than on the value. The dearest ring in Venice will I give you, and find it out by proclamation. Only for this, I pray you pardon me.
I see, sir, you are liberal in offers. You taught me first to beg, and now methinks you teach me how a beggar should be answered.
Good sir, this ring was given me by my wife, and when she put it on, she made me vow that I should neither sell, nor give, nor lose it.
That excuse serves many men to save their gifts. And if your wife be not a mad woman, and know how well I have deserved this ring, she would not hold out enemy for ever for giving it to me. Well, peace be with you.
Exeunt Portia and Nerissa.
My lord Bassanio, let him have the ring. Let his deservings and my love withal be valued against your wife's commandment.
Go, Gratiano, run and overtake him. Give him the ring, and bring him, if thou canst, unto Antonio's house. Away, make haste.
Exit Gratiano.
Come, you and I will thither presently, and in the morning early will we both fly toward Belmont. Come, Antonio.
Exeunt. Scene 2. The same. A street. Enter Portia and Nerissa.
Inquire the Jew's house out. Give him this deed, and let him sign it. We'll away tonight, and be a day before our husband's home. This deed will be well welcome to Lorenzo.
Enter Gratiano.
Fair sir, you are well o'ertaken. My lord Bassanio, upon more advice, hath sent you here this ring, and doth entreat your company at dinner.
That cannot be. His ring I do accept most thankfully, and so I pray you tell him. Furthermore, I pray you show my youth old Shylock's house.
That will I do.
Sir, I would speak to you.
Aside to Portia.
I'll see if I can get my husband's ring, which I did make him swear to keep forever.
To Nerissa.
Thou mayest, I warrant. We shall have old swearing that they did give the rings away to men, but we'll outface them and outswear them too. Away, make haste. Thou know'st where I will tarry.
Come, good sir. Will you show me to this house?
Exeunt. End of Act 4. The Merchant of Venice by William Shakespeare. Act 5. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, visit LibriVox.org. The Merchant of Venice by William Shakespeare. Act 5. Scene 1. Belmont, the avenue to Portia's home. Enter Lorenzo and Jessica.
The moon shines bright in such a night as this, when the sweet wind did gently kiss the trees, and they did make no noise in such a night. Troilus, methinks, mounted the Trojan walls, and sighed his soul toward the Grecian tents where Cressid lay that night.
In such a night did Thisbe fearfully o'ertrip the dew, and saw the lion's shadow ere himself, and ran dismayed away.
In such a night stood Dido with a willow in her hand upon the wild sea-banks, and waft her love to come again to Carthage.
In such a night, Medea gathered the enchanted herbs that did renew old Aeson.
In such a night did Jessica steal from the wealthy Jew, and with an unthrift love did run from Venice as far as Belmont.
In such a night did young Lorenzo swear he loved her well, stealing her soul with many vows of faith, and ne'er a true one.
In such a night did pretty Jessica, like a little shrew, slander her love, and he forgave it her.
I would outnight you, did nobody come. But hark, I hear the footing of a man.
Enter Stefano.
Who comes so fast in silence of the night?
A friend.
A friend? What friend? Your name, I pray you, friend.
Stefano is my name, and I bring word my mistress will before the break of day be here at Belmont. She doth stray about by holy crosses, where she kneels and prays for happy wedlock hours.
Who comes with her?
None but a holy hermit and her maid. I pray you, is my master yet returned?
He is not, nor we have not heard from him. But go we in, I pray thee, Jessica, and ceremoniously let us prepare some welcome for the mistress of the house.
Enter Launcelot.
Sola, sola, wo-ha-ho, sola, sola.
Who calls?
Sola, did you see Master Lorenzo? Master Lorenzo, sola, sola.
Leave helloing, man, here.
Sola, where, where?
Here.
Tell him there's a post come from my master with his horn full of good news. My master will be here ere morning.
Exit.
Sweet soul, let's in, and there expect their coming. And yet, no matter, why should we go in? My friend Stefano, signify, I pray you, within the house, your mistress is at hand, and bring your music forth into the air.
Exit Stefano.
How sweet the moonlight sleeps upon this bank. Here we will sit and let the sounds of music creep in our ears, soft stillness, and the night become the touches of sweet harmony. Sit, Jessica, look how the floor of heaven is thick inlaid with patines of bright gold. There's not the smallest orb which thou behold'st, but in his motion, like an angel sings, still quiring to the young-eyed cherubims, such harmony is in immortal souls. But whilst this muddy vesture of decay doth grossly close it in, we cannot hear it.
Enter musicians.
Come ho, and wake Diana with a hymn. With sweetness touches pierce your mistress's ear, and draw her home with music.
Music.
I am never merry when I hear sweet music.
The reason is, your spirits are attentive, for do not note a wild and wanton herd, or race of youthful and unhandled colts, fetching mad bounds, bellowing and neighing loud, which is the hot condition of their blood. If they but hear, perchance, a trumpet sound, or any air of music touch their ears, you shall perceive them make a mutual stand, their savage eyes turned to a modest gaze, by the sweet power of music. Therefore the poet did feign that Orpheus drew trees, stones, and floods, since not so stockish, hard, and full of rage, but music for the time doth change his nature. The man that hath no music in himself, nor is not moved with concord of sweet sounds, is fit for treasons, stratagems, and spoils. The motions of his spirit are dull as night, and his affections dark as Erebus. Let no such man be trusted. Mark the music.
Enter Portia and Nerissa at a distance.
That light we see is burning in my hall. How far that little candle throws his beams! So shines a good deed in a naughty world.
When the moon shone, we did not see the candle.
So doth the greater glory dim the less. A substitute shines brightly as a king until a king be by, and then his state empties itself, as doth an inland brook into the main of waters. Music, hark!
It is your music, madame, of the house.
Nothing is good, I see, without respect. Methinks it sounds much sweeter than by day.
Silence bestows that virtue on it, madame.
The crow doth sing as sweetly as the lark when neither is attended, and I think the nightingale, if she should sing by day when every goose is cackling, would be thought no better a musician than the wren.
how many things by season seasoned are to their right praise and true perfection. Peace, ho! The moon sleeps with Endymion, and would not be awaked.
Music ceases.
That is the voice, or I am such deceived of Portia.
He knows me as the blind man knows the cuckoo by the bad voice.
Dear lady, welcome home.
We have been praying for our husband's welfare, which speed we hope the better for our words. Are they returned?
Madam, they are not yet, but there has come a messenger before, to signify their coming.
Go in, Nerissa. Give order to my servants that they take no note at all of our being absent hence, nor you, Lorenzo, Jessica, nor you.
A tucket sounds.
Your husband is at hand. I hear his trumpet. We are no tell-tales, madam, fear you not.
This night, methinks, is but the daylight sick. It looks a little paler. 'Tis a day such as the day is when the sun is hid.
Enter Bassanio, Antonio, Gratiano, and their followers.
We should hold day with the Antipodes if you would walk in absence of the sun.
Let me give light, but let me not be light, for a light wife doth make a heavy husband, and never be Bassanio so for me. But God sort all. You are welcome home, my lord.
I thank you, madam. Give welcome to my friend. This is the man, this is Antonio, to whom I am so infinitely bound.
You should in all sense be much bound to him, for as I hear, he was much bound for you.
No more than I am well acquitted of.
Sir, you are very welcome to our house. It must appear in other ways than words, therefore I scant this breathing courtesy.
To Nerissa.
By yonder moon, I swear you do me wrong. In faith, I gave it to the judge's clerk. Would he were gelt that had it, for my part, since you do take it, love so much at heart.
A quarrel, ho, already? What's the matter?
About a hoop of gold, a paltry ring that she did give me, whose posy was for all the world like Cutler's poetry upon a knife, love me and leave me not.
What talk you of the posy or the value? You swore to me when I did give it to you that you would wear it till your hour of death, and that it should lie with you in your grave. Though not for me, yet for your vehement oaths, you should have been respective and have kept it. Gave it to judge's clerk. No, gods, my judge, the clerk will ne'er wear hair on's face that had it.
He will, and if he live to be a man.
Ay, if a woman live to be a man.
Now, by this hand, I gave it to a youth, a kind of boy, a little scrubbed boy no higher than thyself, the judge's clerk, a prating boy that begged it as a fee. I could not for my heart deny it him.
You were to blame. I must be plain with you. To part so slightly with your wife's first gift. A thing stuck on with oaths upon your finger, and so riveted with faith unto your flesh. I gave my love a ring, and made him swear never to part with it. And here he stands. I dare be sworn for him he would not leave it, nor pluck it from his finger for the wealth that the world masters. Now in faith, Gratiano, you give your wife too unkind a cause of grief. And 'twere to me I should be mad at it.
Aside.
Why, I were best to cut my left hand off and swear I lost the ring defending it.
My lord Bassanio gave his ring away unto the judge that begged it, and indeed deserved it too. And then the boy, his clerk, that took some pains in writing, he begged mine, and neither man nor master would take aught but the two rings.
What ring gave you, my lord? Not that, I hope, which you received of me.
If I could add a lie unto a fault, I would deny it, but you see my finger hath not the ring upon it. It is gone.
Even so void is your false heart of truth. By heaven, I will ne'er come in your bed until I see the ring.
Nor I in yours, till I again see mine.
Sweet Portia, if you did know to whom I gave the ring, if you did know for whom I gave the ring, and would conceive for what I gave the ring, and how unwillingly I left the ring, when naught would be accepted but the ring, you would abate the strength of your displeasure.
If you had known the virtue of the ring, or half her worthiness that gave the ring, or your own honour to contain the ring, you would not then have parted with the ring. What man is there so much unreasonable, if you had pleased to have defended it with any terms of zeal, wanted the modesty to urge the thing held as a ceremony? Nerissa teaches me what to believe. I'll die for it, but some woman had the ring.
No, by my honour, madam, by my soul, no woman had it, but a civil doctor, which did refuse 3,000 ducats of me and begged the ring, the which I did deny him and suffered him to go displeased away, even he that had held the life of my dear friend. What should I say, sweet lady? I was enforced to send it after him. I was beset with shame and courtesy. My honour would not let ingratitude so much besmear it. Pardon me, good lady, for by these blessed candles of the night, had you been there, I think you would have begged the ring of me to give the worthy doctor.
Let not that doctor e'er come near my house, since he hath got the jewel that I loved, and that which you did swear to keep for me. I will become as liberal as you. I'll not deny him anything I have, no, not my body, nor my husband's bed. Know him I shall, I am well sure of it. Lie not a night from home, watch me like Argus. If you do not, if I be left alone, now by mine honour, which is yet mine own, I'll have that doctor for mine bedfellow.
And I as clerk, therefore be it well advised how you do leave me to my own protection.
Well, do you so. Let me not take him then, for if I do, I'll mar the young clerk's pen.
I am the unhappy subject of these quarrels.
Sir, grieve not you. You are welcome notwithstanding.
Portia, forgive me this enforced wrong. And, in the hearing of these many friends, I swear to thee, even by thine own fair eyes, wherein I see myself.
Mark you but that. In both my eyes he doubly sees himself, in each eye one. Swear by your double self, and there's an oath of credit.
Nay, but hear me. Pardon this fault, and by my soul I swear I never more will break an oath with thee.
I once did lend my body for his wealth, which, but for him that had your husband's ring, had quite miscarried. I dare be bound again, my soul upon the forfeit, that your lord will never more break faith advisedly.
Then you shall be his surety. Give him this, and bid him keep it better than the other.
Here, Lord Bassanio, swear to keep this ring.
By heaven, it is the same I gave the doctor.
I had it of him. Pardon me, Bassanio, for by this ring the doctor lay with me.
And pardon me, my gentle Gratiano, for that same scrubbed boy, the doctor's clerk, in lieu of this last night did lie with me.
Why, this is like the mending of highways in summer, where the ways are fair enough. What? Are we cuckolds ere we have deserved it?
Speak not so grossly. You are all amazed. Here is a letter. Read it at your leisure. It comes from Padua, from Bellario. There you shall find that Portia was the doctor, Nerissa there her clerk. Lorenzo here shall witness I set forth as soon as you, and even but now returned. I have not yet entered my house. Antonio, you are welcome, and I have better news in store for you than you expect. Unseal this letter soon. There you shall find three of your argosies are richly come to harbour suddenly. You shall not know by what strange accident I chanced on this letter.
I am dumb.
Were you the doctor? And I knew you not?
Were you the clerk that is to make me cuckold?
Aye, but the clerk that never means to do it, unless he live until he be a man.
Sweet doctor, you shall be my bedfellow. When I am absent, then lie with my wife.
Sweet lady, you have given me life and living, for here I read for certain that my ships are safely come to road.
How now, Lorenzo? My clerk hath some good comforts too for you.
Aye, and I'll give them him without a fee. Therefore I do give to you and Jessica, from the rich Jew, a special deed of gift, after his death, of all he dies possessed of.
Fair ladies, you drop manna in the way of starved people.
It is almost morning, and yet I am sure you are not satisfied of these events at full. Let us go in, and charge us there upon interrogatories, and we will answer all things faithfully.
Let it be so. The first interrogatory that my Nerissa shall be sworn on is, where till the next night she had rather stay, or go to bed now, being 2 hours to-day. But were the day come, I should wish it dark, till I were couching with the doctor's clerk. Well, while I live, I'll fear no other thing so sore as keeping safe Nerissa's ring.
Exeunt. End of Act 5, and End of The Merchant of Venice by William Shakespeare.